I am Attorney General Rob Bonta. I'm here with my friend and colleague, Assemblymember Stephanie Nguyen. We are here today to talk about some important work that the California Department of Justice has been leading and an important legislative effort that Assemblymember Nguyen is leading. And we're proud and grateful here at the California DOJ for the partnership for Assemblymember Nguyen's leadership in this space and many other spaces, and to be able to announce our initiatives today. Let me first just say that you'll hear from the assembly member in a moment. And I always like to acknowledge the critical team members within the California DOJ who are doing this important work. They do it because they know it's important. They're mission driven. They do it when no one's looking. But I want to recognize them for their important work, including Director of Bureau of Forensic Services, Barry Miller, and Assistant Director of Bureau of Forensic Services, Nikki Duda, as well as from our Office of Legislative Affairs, Director Amy Alley, who is here, and Legislative Policy Advocate Candace Chung, who has worked very hard on this important effort. We are proud to be announcing the introduction by Assemblymember Nguyen of AB 3042 and look forward to working in partnership to get this bill passed. The unfortunate reality is that the work that we lead at the DOJ, unfortunately, frequently stems from tragic events, violent crimes, and untimely deaths. So we see families and loved ones in very difficult times. There's nothing any of us can do to undo the harm or bring back a loved one gone too soon. We know that. But our hope is that by seeking justice for those who've been who've gone missing or who have been killed, by seeking justice for families left with oftentimes more questions than answers, we can bring some semblance of peace, that we can help bring some healing, some closure to their lives. Justice, peace, and healing is at the core of the DOJ's work, of the Bureau of Forensic Services mission. And one way we fulfill that mission is through advanced forensic DNA services and technology, which is the platform and the pathway for providing these answers. Our programs use this technology to do many things: identifying missing persons, solving child abduction cases, analyzing rape and sexual assault evidence kits, helping local law enforcement identify samples collected at crime scenes, exonerate innocent individuals, testify in court, and further advance research and developments in forensic science. So there is many applications, much good that is done through this technology. And all of this work is made possible in part by funding provided through the voter-approved Proposition 69, which is set to sunset this year. It was passed 20 years ago. It will no longer provide any funding going forward if not for Assemblymember Nguyen's bill. And so we want to change that. That funding is important. It's provided great progress and benefits for many years, and we hope that it will continue to do so with this bill. And to this bill will eliminate the sunset, establish a permanent, steady source of revenue to support DNA programs like the ones housed in DOJ's Bureau of Forensic Services. Local law enforcement as well receive funding and are able to do similar work to what we do. The funding made available from AB 3042 would be allocated, just to be clear, to both state and to local crime labs to expand a wide swath of efforts being led to collect and test DNA samples and ultimately to solve crimes. That is the ultimate outcome of these funds. Funds from Prop 69 currently support all of the Bureau of Forensic Services programs that take advantage of DNA investigative technology. And just to give you some examples of what this funding has led to, the funds helped our team solve the cold case of 79-year-old Lucille Hultgren, who was found dead in her home in Galt in 1988. 34 years later, three decades and a half later, thanks to advances in DNA technology, we were able to use the fingernail scrapings to find a DNA match to a local man. That man had since died, but regardless, this work brought long overdue closure to Ms. Hultgren's son. Prop 69 funds also helped make it possible for us to analyze a rapid DNA kit collected from, very tragically and horrifically, a young girl who had been molested at her daycare. We were able to match the DNA to the daycare owner's husband, who later pled guilty and was sentenced to 21 years to life. These funds also supported our work to exonerate 60-year-old Horace Roberts, who was wrongfully convicted in 1999 of strangling Terry Cheek, with whom he was having an affair. And a DNA analysis in 2017 found that Mr. Roberts' DNA wasn't under Miss Cheek's fingernails, and reversing his conviction and leading to the arrest and charge of Miss Cheek's estranged husband and his nephew. So those are some examples of applications of this important funding, how it does justice, how it provides answers, how it solves crimes. And importantly, this funding, I want to just highlight, would come from a voter-approved and already established source, criminal fines, which is, to be absolutely clear, in this difficult budget year, completely separate and apart from the general fund. This is a separate source of funding. And how much does it provide? It is significant. The Prop 69 fund generates approximately $12 million per year for state and local public crime labs. Over the two decades since Prop 69 was passed, DOJ has received more than $74 million. And we need AB 3042 because we must be able to continue to use DNA technology to solve crimes like the ones mentioned today and so many others. And so that brings me to the second part of today's press conference, which is DOJ's Missing Persons DNA program, which we are very proud of, the work that it does. Since 2001, it has identified over 2,000 missing persons. This program uses voluntary DNA, voluntarily provided DNA from personal articles from a missing person and from their relatives to match against unidentifiable remains. And I want to underscore that this program is voluntary. It's up to relatives to decide if they want to participate. And we only ever use these voluntary provided DNA samples to search for missing persons and identify human remains. We never use those DNA samples to search against a criminal or offender DNA database. Thanks to the hard work and dedication of DOJ's Bureau of Forensic Services, the families and friends and loved ones of more than 2,000 individuals have some answers. They have some closure. That includes the family of Christine Lester, a Navajo woman who went missing from northern Arizona in 1987. Last April, we were able to use this program to help identify her skeletal remains that were found on the side of a rural county road in Madera County. It also includes the family of baby Nico Lee Perez, an infant whose remains were found in an irrigation canal in Yolo County. Because of the discovery made possible by the program, Nico's father was subsequently charged with his son's murder and the murder of his four siblings. So certainly there's nothing celebratory about this work, but the fact that we've identified over 2,000 missing persons is meaningful. It's a reminder of what we can accomplish for the people of California when we have the appropriate resources, which will be provided by this bill. So let me just say in close that as a son, as a brother, a husband, a father of three incredible children, I can't fathom the pain, the hardship of losing a loved one and being left with more questions than answers. I can't imagine what it would feel like to wonder if my loved one is missing or worse, and to wonder if I'll ever know what really happened. So we can't undo untimely deaths. We can't reunite grieving families. We can't erase the trauma caused by the violent crimes, but we can do our best to provide answers, to solve unsolved crimes, to help provide closure. So again, proud of the work that our DOJ has done and grateful for the work our local partners have done across this state for two decades with this bill. It is our hope and our desire that we will be able to continue that work funded by sources outside the general fund and continue to bring justice and peace and healing to California families in need. Before I open it up for questions, I will be back for questions. I'd like to introduce my friend and great leader right here from Sacramento, Assemblymember Stephanie Nguyen, who is the author of this great bill and is here to say a few words. Assemblymember Nguyen.
Thank you, sir. Before I start, I do want to thank the Attorney General and the office for partnering with us on this very important piece of legislation. As he mentioned, there have been numerous amounts of cases that have been solved and that families have had closures. This Proposition 69 passed over 20 years ago, nearly 20 years ago, with over 60% of the voters saying yes, this needs to be funded. Yes, this needs to happen. And since then, over 106,000 code cases have been solved. I'd like to also note that some of the ones in the area here that received national recognition was the Golden State Killer, the East Area Rapist. Those were 40-year-old cases that have been closed, families having closure. And so it is such an honor for me not only to partner with the Attorney General's office to carry this, but I think it's something that many community members also appreciate as well too. As our Attorney General mentioned, families from little to older adults, all across the gamut runs, to those that can be exonerated and set free because they were innocent from the very beginning. This bill will continue to do that for our community here. And I want to thank the Attorney General's office, your team, and everybody else that had played a role in this to help us in continuing this piece of legislation. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Senator.